Well, I recently was at a conference on emotions, and someone asked me, well, what do you do? Well, I wasn't doing anything on emotions, so I told her I'm doing early modern legislation. But obviously, that's the wrong answer. Because I got scrolled by a colleague for telling that person that, because I do a lot of cool stuff with digital humanities, and if as soon as I say that I'm working on early modern legislation, people start to try to find a way to the exits, and they won't invite me to talk, whereas my agenda is kind of full with giving workshops on Transkribus. So in a way, research becomes a lot sexier when you're working on Transkribus, or when you're using Transkribus, because, well, that is something people are willing to get a bit of interest in and start understanding it. So even though I can write some pretty interesting articles, I think, on how governments function and on legislation, that's not something that most people seem to be interested in, although this one did get a few hits in 3 weeks' time. I wanted to share some experiences on using Transkribus for a little bit over 4 years now. And I figured that I put them into 10 lessons, and that still allows me to show you some of the pictures of the stuff that I'm dealing with. So when I work with early modern legislation, and when I started this endeavor of learning to work with digital humanities, I had no idea what I was getting into, which may have been a good thing. It was a long learning curve, but an interesting one. And I started that with the KB National Library, where I was doing a fellowship, and I was working with a computer scientist, and they also assigned me a project manager. And I had no idea why I would need a project manager, but it turned out I spoke an entirely different language than my computer scientist colleague. So the first question, or basically the starting point, is what are you going to do? And that may sound like a really easy question, but I wanted to segment legal texts and then figure out how to automatically metadata them. What I didn't know, and that's bringing me to the second thing, is that layout matters, because the computer doesn't understand what layout is. For me, it's obvious where there is a title, and if there's a next title, then anything in between happens to be the body of the text. But apparently the computer is stupid, and I have to tell them everything, which I didn't know. So I started using Transkribus after a couple of workshops by Louise Seward back then. And I was kind of enthusiastic about creating models and running them over my pages, which was nice. I could easily read them. I could search for words. But then the computer didn't know my titles. So layout really matters, and it's important to pay attention to it. And even though 2 years ago the computer couldn't, you could not do the text recognition first and then the layout analysis, that has been improved by now. So that's a good thing. So that makes life a lot easier. But it's still important to think about whether it matters for your output and whether you need to pour time into it, because layout analysis is, in my opinion, the most boring part, and you want to start with the boring part, because then the good stuff still has to come. One of the things I learned, especially when giving workshops, is that you need to keep your transcriptions in a loop. So even though we keep saying you need to have 30 pages of transcriptions, that's a really cool thing, but it's also bloody annoying if you have a very hard handwriting. So I start with 5 pages and then create a very small model, and hopefully it works a little bit on my next pages, and I can save a little bit of time. And I keep trying to do that. Even though the model is pretty easy, it makes my life quite a lot easier in the long run, because those 30 pages is something I really do not like having to do. What I also learned, especially from my computer scientist colleague and that programmer and that project manager, but also within the institute where I now work, is that it's very important to talk to various disciplines, because understanding what is going on helps you also think about that process and makes you adapt to it. Plus, it makes you sound smart, and that also gets you invited sometimes. You can bridge between disciplines. And what I tell my students these days is that that is really the key in our future jobs. No one's going to, well, I still have some hope that someone's going to hire me as a historian who knows a lot about legal history, but chances are quite limited. So in order to increase my chances, knowing a little bit about digital humanities might help. And again, if you just look at your research, it helps you to anticipate on what you might be expecting as outcomes or what you could try to meddle with. And yeah, well, kind of obvious, teach what you preach. It's a fun thing to do workshops, because if you talk to people and you get to teach them how to use a tool or anything about digital humanities, it's kind of helpful to also have that settle in your own mind and have that trickle down in your system, and not just, okay, I click this button and I click this button, but you have to think about that whole process. And that really helps just also for your own understanding. So even though if you're using it and you're explaining it to a colleague, that can be really helpful for your own thinking process. The fun part is obviously that people tend to have the idea of understanding that you are working on old handwriting and that the computer can help you. I tried that with the people I was in the train last night, and they actually came up with the idea, so I can read my grandfather's handwriting. Uh-huh, yeah, you can. But as soon as I told them that I normally work on 17th century handwriting of legislation, they were like, okay, so that's interesting. And also cool, especially if you are still at the early stages of your career, publishing models and data counts as a publication. And when I did my dissertation, I did a whole lot of transcriptions by hand. Well, and that didn't count as publications, but now I'm training models and I'm learning the computer how to read a certain hand. And that does count as a publication. So that looks cool on my list. And then, well, you history may be a slow science because, well, writing a book is taking you 4 years, at least for a dissertation. And then it takes a couple of years more to rewrite the whole damn thing. But then if you're working with the digital humanities, then and you're using Transkribus, then you have data sets and you have models. And as some of you heard with the workshop, we can still make that output and figure out smart ways of referencing that. So that's cool. What you do need to be aware of is that techniques changes. So we just heard this morning that expert is going to get out of the system and we have to get used to light, which, well, that's a bit traumatic for me to hear this morning, given the number of webinars I gave on expert and how many times that has been viewed. But yeah, there are new options as well, like named entity recognition, which is very interesting that we can now adopt that within a model. And that also needs to be something that you put in a footnote, that you created the model like 2 years ago and you couldn't do named entity recognition yet. So that's not incorporated in your model, because otherwise you will get comments from your reviewers that, oh boy, you didn't incorporate named entity recognition. So you kind of need to be aware that the technique changes and that you need to account for the moment that you wrote or created a model or created the data set and what you could not yet include, but something that from hindsight you could now do. So that's something to be aware of, and you might want to go back on your steps and change it later on. And then, it's worth investing your time in, because, when I was applying for the grant that I'm currently working my project on, I had to do this interview in front of this panel, and I really hope they are not in the digital crowd, because I know they are not here. But I had this professor asking me why I didn't put Transkribus in my timetable, because that was going to take a lot of time to put everything into a computer program and then use that. Well, guess what? It saves a lot of time. But somehow I do manage to get my agenda filled anyway. So I'm not I'm not entirely saving time. I'm still doing more stuff. That's also fun. But working with Transkribus certainly made doing research a lot more interesting. And I'm not sure if you would have listened to me if I were giving a talk about the early modern legislation. So thank you for your attention.